No.
Okay. Sorry. Yeah, I don't know why it's showing me offline. I'm definitely here and was waiting. So one of the mysteries of Skype.
Indeed. Yeah, I mean, I tried to call and it wasn't quite working. I'm just checking that my recording software is working because I'm recording this call. That's fine, yeah?
Yeah, that's fine.
Cool. Okay, yeah, good. So a few technical issues to start the day, but never mind. It's 9 o'clock there, is it?
Yep. Bright and early.
Very early. Yeah, so we've got a conference coming up on the 23rd with quite a lot of NGOs, ethical consumer organizations, and all sorts of things there. So we're doing some research on what everyone's doing around the world.
Sure.
Which we've done before, and we talked to Dara before. I suppose we're interviewing about 10, 12 different organizations. So, yeah, we wanted to talk to you about Good Guide and how Good Guide differentiates itself from other organizations, what sort of characteristics you think are really important to mention to Good Guide. I should ask first, really, how much time do you have?
I've got as much as you need, so I don't actually have anything that's going to chop me off. So I assume we'd spend probably about a half hour, but it's really completely up to you.
Yeah. Okay. I mean, yeah, I'm fine. Once you think you've told everyone that you need to tell them.
Yeah.
So, yeah, tell me about Good Guide.
Okay. Well, so should I actually start really top level general, or are you going to be doing some intros to who the various people are that are?
Well, what I'm going to do, I mean, your audience really is other ethical consumption organizations.
Okay.
So they know kind of the industry, if you like.
Yeah.
They may not know about what Good Guide is particularly doing in the area, but they will be informed. So consider that to be your audience.
Okay. So, I mean, basically, Good Guide has evolved from what was originally an academic research project founded by Dara O'Rourke at UC Berkeley into an online commercial service, information service. We now actually rate about 150,000 different products on the
Wow.
U.S. market and make that information available to consumers through either our iPhone app, our website, or through basically toolbar browser add-ons that bring Good Guide information right to people at the point that they're making a purchasing decision. So I think the big evolution in Good Guide has been from what I would characterize as sort of like an encyclopedic site. You know, we focus on a number of consumer product categories that consumers purchase regularly. So personal care, household chemical products, foods, paper supplies, light bulbs, that sort of thing. And the original sort of thought for Good Guide was there are enough ethical consumers out there that they would seek us out, do their research online, and then basically sort of proceed to use the information they learned from us in their offline shopping experience. I think that was that proved to be a real challenge. At least in the U.S., the number of people who are actively seeking sort of corporate social responsibility or environmental or health performance information on products is actually relatively small. So it's a very dedicated audience that's willing to do that kind of research, particularly for, you know, relatively low cost expenditures like, you know, food or personal care products. So what we realized was we needed to make it easier for people to have easy, actionable access to the information right when they were making a purchasing decision. It couldn't be a service that relied on people's sort of research initiative. We basically needed to be bringing the information into the shopping process and basically disrupting the shopping experience, essentially placing ourselves, Good Guide, as another information source in what has traditionally been sort of like a two-way or even largely one-way communication between major brand marketers and consumers. So the way we've done that is through the mobile app. And I think the experience we've had, so we have iPhone and mobile and Android apps. The experience we've had with that is that that is also a relatively small part of the world right now, sort of part of the consumer market that's using these types of online tools right in stores. Now, more and more people are scanning products, more and more people are taking their mobile devices into stores, but it's still a relatively infrequent behavior. And so our concern has been the adoption rate of scan a product, get a rating, then decide right there in real time you want to look for other products in the store or you want to buy something different is still basically cumbersome. And so we've, in the last 6 months, moved to these browser-based add-ons that operate primarily with online e-commerce stores, so Amazon.com or Walmart.com or basically any e-commerce store. And it allows you to get a good guide rating of a product, if we've got one, right there in real time as you're browsing in an e-commerce environment, and it shows you whether or not product X meets your particular personal filter. So one of the other things we've really realized is to expand the audience for sort of ethical information in the consumption process. You actually need to be able to sort of slice and dice up what you're saying into sort of thin attributes that are really what different segments of the consuming public care about. When Good Guide approached this initially, it was, we have a definition of good that we think is fairly reasonable. It spans environmental and social performance. It covers everything from supply chain management to whether a company is engaged in the communities that it's operating in to how it's addressing global climate change. And I think one of the things we've learned is that that breadth of definition of goodness is what is not actually of interest to a lot of consumers. Most consumers who want to shop an ethical preference have a very refined preference. It might be animal friendly. It might be they do care about global warming. It might be they don't want to subsidize sweatshops. But they really don't want that preference kind of blended into a whole bunch of other information that is essentially some other third party saying, here's the definition of good. So we have disaggregated a lot of the information that we use in rating companies and products back into single attributes in order to let people basically build filters so that you can say, I don't want to buy any personal care products that have, you know, the following kinds of toxic ingredients, or I don't want to buy any personal care products, household chemical products that have been tested on animals. And that's the only thing that matters to me. And I want you to tell me right when I'm looking at this product, whether it actually passes or fails my personal filters. And so the Good Guide evolution is headed towards being able to provide that kind of personal filter information right at the point a decision is being made to buy a product, and to also make it really easy right at that point to become aware of what the alternative products are that perform better on that attribute that an individual consumer cares about. So that's basically the sort of evolution of Good Guide's information message and also how it tries to get that information into the decision-making process that consumers have.
Wonderful. I actually have, although don't tell anyone, I have an iPhone, which is not the most ethical of products, I know. I feel very bad about it, but I do have your app on it as well, and it's wonderful.
Great.
Yeah, really, really does hit the mark. Do you feel that any of your users may have greater curiosity in terms of how your ratings are assembled? I've been going around your site. I have it in front of me now. I can't really dig deep down too far into really understanding where these numbers come from.
Right. And I think that's a really good question, and it's been a real challenge for us over time. Because like I said, we started from this encyclopedic approach. And so I'd actually argue that, you know, relative to most other CSR systems that are out there, certainly anything that's operating at the product level, we have a tremendous amount of information. But so you'll see we score product X or the company that makes product X on, say, its global warming policies, and it has a high score or a low score. You won't right now see what that policy actually is. Similarly, if you know some company has been locked in controversies about its supply chain practices, say an Apple or something like that, you'll see it score low on supply chain related issues having to do with the social score, but you won't actually see, you know, narratives that describe, well, actually Apple has a couple of different problems in its supply chain, part is Foxconn, part is somebody else. And there's a couple of reasons for that. One is that to actually deliver a useful service, you need to be able to talk about most products that people confront in the marketplace. And so we have found ourselves heavily constrained by how much information is available and at what price on both products and companies. And so, for example, one way that we enable ourselves to scale is to purchase essentially sort of CSR data sets on public companies from major providers like Thomson Reuters or IWF Financial or Asset4 that are used to generating this kind of information for the socially responsible investment market. They all have restrictions on how much of their raw data you can actually display to the end user, and we basically have to comply with that. And then the other – so one factor is just, you know, can you get that information and how easy is it to get it and how affordable is it to acquire it? And the other is we certainly have a very sort of split audience, right? There's a portion of our audience that really wants to know the full story. And I think those probably would – that portion of our audience would typically align with this sort of traditional, truly committed ethical consumer. Like I said, that's a pretty small slice of the overall part of the market that actually cares enough about some social or environmental issue to make it a factor in their purchasing decision. Most of those folks tend to just want to get the process over with. Tell me whether or not it's good or bad on attribute Y. I'm really not here to learn. I've decided I'm going to trust you. Tell me yes or no. And there the role of the more detailed encyclopedic information or narrative is it still has a role. It's not something that most consumers want to dig into for each and every shampoo purchase they make. They mainly want to dig into it just to make sure that we're credible. So I think it's it has a kind of different dynamic. And then obviously adding into the complexity of how much information you display is that as you try to get into the purchasing process itself, right where the person is making a choice between product X and product Y, you have to be in there with a very small amount of salient, actionable information. That's what you're trying to – you're really not trying to guide people's – purchasing practices through a larger educational practice, which is sort of what we originally started out thinking we were going to do. And instead, you're really just trying to get in there and give a very strong signal, this passes or fails on the social or environmental preference you care the most about. And in that context, actually, additional information kind of weakens your ability to influence that ultimate decision. So it's been a real challenge for us. We face these contending pressures to really be able to let people dig all the way down to raw data. And we're starting to deal with that in some of our technology by ultimately, I think we'll be able to replace our reliance on some of these commercial data vendors and scrape
Wonderful.
And manage all this information ourselves. Be able to have it in a online store, in essentially an online sort of reference service that lets you dig down into the Apple controversies or something like that when you want it. And we have license rights and the ability to publish it freely. Right now, we don't.
Okay. Have you considered including qualitative data in your systems, potentially taken from third-party journalistic sources and analyzed by yourselves?
Yeah, so I'm not I would say we do that already. Maybe I'm not sure quite what you consider qualitative. So we will look, for example, when we're rating a company, particularly if we're rating it using our own research rather than one of these licensed data sources, we will look at a company's own CSR reports. We will look at the reports that have been written by major NGOs that are operating, say, in different arenas, whether it's Greenpeace or something, you know, more relevant to the supply chain management or worker rights side. And we will distill from those. Often we love to find those types of reports that include grading systems because we'll basically try to integrate that third-party grading system directly into our ratings. So we do that now, for example, in our apparel company ratings. We have also in our electronics ratings, they include Greenpeace's consideration of their, and rating of their post, consumer use life cycle impact assessment stuff. we try to bring in any kind of authoritative information that's being developed that's credible. So I would consider those sort of qualitative sources. You know, the challenge there with that type of thing is that, again, because we want to be able to have the end user experience be, I'm in a store, I'm looking at 100 different products, I can get information that helps me sort between at least like 80% of them. The challenge has been most of the types of focused ratings work that really dives deep and is very informative from the NGO community in particular tends to address only the top brands in some product sector space. And so your ability to talk about everything is really constrained. And so that's just a general limit that we have. You know, it's like when your model is try to be able to put everything onto the same scale within, say, a product category and cover at least 80% of the products that constitute 80% of the total volume of products being sold in that category, you end up constrained by I can't make use of a really good data source because it only covers whatever, the top five producers in that space, when in fact there's at least 20 or 30 different manufacturing companies involved, and you need to be able to say something about all of them.
Sure. Okay. The reason I mention qualitative data, and by that I mean, let's say we pull in reports from a newspaper that has no external grading system in it, but are very relevant.
Right.
And of course, we'd like to put that into the analysis, but we would have to make very opinionated decisions on how to score it in the absence of any actual quantitative gradings in it.
Right.
The reason I mentioned that sort of input, and I get the impression that you do consider those sorts of things. Obviously, like you're saying, you look for quantitative analysis in order to set up rules about those things. But, you know, is because we're also interested in asking you about crowdsourcing.
Yeah.
So, you know, you undoubtedly know what crowdsourcing is, but to just kind of flesh it out, it's the idea of allowing the people that use your system, if they wanted to actually put in their own qualitative, opinionated analysis and come to decisions together about the scoring of these sorts of third-party journalistic sources. Has Good Guide considered that sort of thing?
Yeah, and actually we're about to do a whole new release in the middle. Well, it'll probably be by the end of October of this fall of essentially a new company rating system that's really been designed around the idea that we need to be able to accept evidence from users and incorporate that into the rating system. So I'll kind of explain how that works in a minute. You know, we do currently use media as a major source, particularly in regard to information about compliance issues or controversies. And you're absolutely right. There's a kind of qualitative judgmental component of our rating system, and that we have to go through. And basically what we do right now is pretty rudimentary, but I think it's the best that can be done because of the amount of manual work that's required. Is, you know, we subscribe to these LexisNexis type services that aggregate all press coverage, say, about a brand, and then score it based on, you know, well, what issue is the story about? So we need to know sort of like, well, what performance component is actually being addressed by some media story? And then is it a, you know, serious controversy or a minor controversy? So we count the number of serious and minor controversies. And we have definitions for what constitutes, you know, serious versus minor. But obviously you lose a tremendous amount of information in that kind of aggregation. And so part of the solution to that is to keep a record and be able to publish what the original raw information was. That we're kind of working on separately. Your description of crowdsourcing is, I think from our perspective, we're probably less interested in having people evaluate whether or not we correctly scored piece of evidence X as serious versus minor, and more have people participate in our system by actually seeing that, okay, you guys have scored, let's say we scored Apple really good on supply chain or labor management issues. They think there's evidence that counters that. what the new rating system will give our users is the ability to essentially identify evidence relevant to an issue that they should believe they believe should be included in our rating. So it doesn't actually have them participate in the scoring of their evidence per se. That we actually want to have a relatively standardized and unbiased approach to. But it does give them the ability to actually say, and it actually is completely bilateral, so it's open to companies as well. Apple sees that we say they suck on latest reviews and wants to provide a case of, hey, you guys have ignored what we've just done with our supply chain. We have now fully disclosed who all of our suppliers are or whatever. We want you to consider that. So it would work. It is designed to work with either company or user-submitted information to inject the crowd's evidence into our overall information collection process. The other way we rely on crowd is basically separate from what the rating is, are people's attitudes towards the brand or a product. And we do essentially kind of collect what I would consider user-generated content just simply with sort of a Facebook-like thumbs up, thumbs down at both the product and the company level. So you can see that even though a good guide rates something well, a good example of this is in some of our pet food ratings, some of our top-rated pet foods are really disliked by a lot of our users. And so you'll see a conflict, you know, hey, we don't think you guys were right in how you rated these guys. And users can use the user-based ratings or the good guide ratings to sort between products or make their own decisions. We also collect, my general approach to crowdsourcing is that, you know, it's actually, if you're trying to maintain a relatively standardized evaluative framework and system, it's actually, there's constraints on how much of it you can kind of turn over to the crowd. There are clearly areas where the crowd is in a much better position to deliver information than we ourselves are in right now. And so actually we've added this capability to let people provide evidence about a company's performance on X or Y, largely to make our system more open and transparent. I'm not anticipating that we will get a tremendous amount of information into our system through those mechanisms. We'll see. I'm more actually interested in addressing attributes that matter to consumers, particularly related to the quality and performance of a product that are simply not ascertainable from anyone other than consumer users of the product. Unless we were to go out and invest in like consumer reports type testing, which we don't have the resources for. So, you know, many of the constraints, for example, at least according to market surveys, that people feel about, you know, should I buy this green product or not, is concerned about whether it will work as well as the brand name product that they're used to. I actually don't have access to any information source online or through any of my licensed data sources that can tell you how well Cleaner X works. And so that, to me, is a perfect type of data element for crowdsourcing, getting people to essentially build the equivalent of, the kind of results you might see from a consumer report. It's still not going to be literal testing of cleaning efficacy or something like that, but you're going to know more or less if you get significant number of comments that this product, you know, does clean your dishes or doesn't, or, you know, my kids hate the smell of this sunscreen or whatever the efficacy information is. That also we think is very ripe for crowdsourcing. So we're going to move toward, we already have the ability to essentially collect a sort of structured review from consumers about a product, and where we need more use to start to get the kind of efficacy information at a sufficiently high enough volume that we actually feel like it would be reliable to turn back over to people. Sort of like what you see sure. with Amazon ratings. You know, it's like, and we use Amazon ratings as well. There's a, you know, 1 to 5 star system. You know, the 5 star products generally have a lot of, you know, many good attributes, including performance. It's not only performance, but it is a good, it's about the best signal you can get out of the current kind of data world about whether the product works or not. So I see a lot of potential in crowdsourcing. We do think it has to be highly structured, and that's part of the challenge for us is that, you know, for example, we debated and then decided not to crowdsource you know, we know about product X, but we don't know what ingredients are in product X. And we want, and all of our health ratings are based on ingredients. So until we get that, you know, now obviously some consumer out there holding the product in their hand may even have the ingredient list. But actually,
sure, yeah.
It's a real nightmare to try to collect information that needs to be very correctly acquired in order to be reliable.
Sure, of course, yeah.
Chemical name matching, that kind of stuff.
We've talked an awful lot about the quality of data, the efficiency of ways of getting that data to the consumer. I'd like to talk about marketing now.
Sure.
Trying to get more people wanting to ethically consume, more people wanting to get involved with this data, more people wanting to use these methods that the data is being delivered to them. And again, I'd like to link back to crowdsourcing, because I think crowdsourcing is commonly looked at purely as a way of getting more data, and there are concerns about data quality. There is another aspect to crowdsourcing, which is crowdsourcing purely as a marketing exercise.
Sure.
By allowing someone to take control of a system to make the information in that theirs, they experience some ownership of the system. And therefore, it could be argued that they spread the system themselves and are more encouraged to use it more and more. Do you have any views on this?
Well, I think that that's absolutely correct. So we do have some dedicated users who make major contributions, for example, to our UPC database, because they're out there scanning products we don't currently cover, getting us UPC products that then need to be rated, essentially building our category coverage. And they are also incredibly – they stand out amongst our user base as the ones who market our service the most to their friends. So I think there's the underlying premise, which is that somebody who's kind of engaged in constructing the service is more likely to help push information or market it to others is definitely key. I do think that it's, you know, one in – it's certainly not the most important, and it is only one of several major factors governing whether or not you can actually get the crowd to essentially virally market the service that you're offering. And so, you know, we view, you know, our marketing strategy, because we don't have tons of money, we are venture backed, but we don't have tons of money, has not been, you know, sock puppets at the, you know, on big TV game days, stuff like that. It really has been restricted to, you know, we know that there's a, in the U.S. at least, it's called there's a market segment called the, you know, those who pursue lifestyles of health and sustainability, the LOHAS market.
Yeah.
And, you know, they have certain websites they go to, certain bloggers they listen to, that sort of thing. And obviously that's where we invest a lot of our marketing attention, because in our minds, those are the most likely early adopters of a service like ours. One of the real challenges, just to be quite honest, is that, you know, I think there's a lot of hard things about getting people to shop smarter and better. And the, you know, most of the activity that's occurring in this space is, you know, shop cheaper. So comparison shopping engines, whether they're mobile apps or websites, have a very good adoption rate. Anything beyond price is still pretty edge at this point, right? So it's like injecting information about environmental or social performance. It's probably the way we characterize it is a kind of price is the most salient attribute, quality is second, competing with price, and then really a distant third, quite honestly, are the types of social or environmental attributes that all of us that are interested in ethical consuming have something to say about. So the challenge is, you know, when it's not such a salient attribute, how do you get people to adopt the service and, you know, and promote the service? And so promotion could be by engaging our most engaged users with crowdsourcing. It could be incentivized promotion the way you will see some groups basically, whatever, giving points or, you know, some kind of discount, coupons or whatever for getting their friends to adopt an application or a service. It can also be, you know, just by virtue of the way you've designed your app, it's such a clever, gamey type thing that everybody adopts it just because it's cool to fiddle around with on an iPhone or something like that. There's a lot of different strategies for getting that kind of viral promotion. Quite honestly, we haven't hit on the right one. The challenge with the crowdsourcing strategy in that marketing effort is that you are restricted back to your best marketers being the very small number of people who are really into, you know, helping the Good Guide mission or building the Good Guide product portfolio or supporting an organization that is designed, you know, focused on ethical consuming. And there's too few of them. They're not enough to kind of seed the full, to basically be able to move the dial when you're, you know, remember we're in an environment where, you know, eBay's red laser application is probably, you know, in at least it's on millions of handheld devices. So, you know, the Good Guide application is on hundreds of thousands coming up close to 1 million, but it's taken us 3.5 years to get there. So the getting to the scale where everybody's using it, which is what's kind of required for it to really have an impact on the larger market in terms of moving purchasing decisions incrementally in a better direction, we're still some way from that. And we definitely don't feel like we have found the kind of golden bullet for how to get particularly the non-core audience, the true, you know, the folks who aren't the dedicated ethical consumers to adopt this. And we even find, quite honestly, challenges with the core audience. I mean, one of the things that's interesting for me, at least, I'm a scientist, is that, you know, you have these folks who are quite well-meaning and truly dedicated to whatever it is, animal-friendly purchasing or, you know, no sweatshop purchasing. Folks who are really dedicated have their own idea about sort of who's good and what's bad and what you should consider. And one of the real challenges for us is that they often disagree with what we have to say. We're generally aligned with them, but they'll spend as much time, you know, whacking us. I'd rather have them spend that time marketing us, but they really don't feel we adequately reflect the intensity of their passion and their perspective on an issue. And so we lose a certain proportion of even the dedicated audience as marketers due to that kind of, these guys are a little bit too reasonable for me, I think would be I don't know, but that's probably the incorrect way to describe our position, but it's like we're maybe make too much of an effort to be balance, to acknowledge uncertainties, to not only adopt a very prevention-oriented or precautionary approach. And that gets reflected. We rate some products that other people might consider objectionable, sometimes relatively well. And that affects this desire to spread the word.
Sure. Yeah. Can I ask you, what sort of indications do you have of your active user base? You've said you've had almost a million downloads of your mobile app. What's the active usage of the mobile app, the browser plugin, and the website?
Well, the browser plugin's only been out for about a month, so it's still in the low hundreds of thousands in terms of installs. The app has been out for, like I said, 3 years, gone through numerous iterations, recently been made available on Android. And then obviously there's the website, you know, unique user account. So we're basically sort of hovering at around a million unique uses through various access devices per month. Probably bigger than anything else that's out there that tries to do what we're doing, but not big enough when you think of a Yahoo that's at 600 million uniques a month and, you know, that sort of thing. Our challenge has been how do you actually scale this? You know, it's expensive to generate this information. I'm sure anybody who's engaged in an ethical consuming project knows how much time and energy, the money they're putting into actually trying to say something smart about issue X. And, you know, you're generally operating in this larger environment of everybody wants this information for free. Nobody wants to pay for it. You yourself want to provide it for free so that there's no friction in terms of being able to get it into people's hands and change decisions. And it's very expensive to create. So the key for us, at least as a commercial enterprise, has been to try to figure out, you know, well, is a million uniques sufficient if it's concentrated in, for example, amongst concerned moms in the U.S. marketplace who marketers are very interested in because they control recurring purchases in the home. So we've had to start to think about how we describe the extent of our reach in ways that better reflect the value of our information to our target audience. We're not trying to compete with the New York Times or some other media entity. We're really trying to become a useful service to at least part of the consuming public in a way that sends a signal back to manufacturers that, you know, my early adopters or the people who buy most of my products or the people who influence their friends to purchase certain categories of products, those folks are all using Good Guide. So we're really primarily at this point focused on sort of like quality of audience and whether they have some reach, some ability to, you know, essentially serve as influencers of others. And then also, you know, trying to make that whole process of engaging those consumers meaningful to those consumers in a larger sense of their life. And that's a really tough thing to do because, you know, we're it's like people do many things that have environmental and social consequences. Purchasing personal care, household chemical, you know, even car, you know, the products that Good Guide covers, it's only a small part of this overall picture. How do you get them, you know, it's like there are things they could do to change global warming that have to do with the heat settings of and cooling settings of their home that are probably bigger in terms of actual impact on their per person CO2 emissions than any of their product purchases combined, except for potentially their car.
Well, of course, I mean, you know, part of ethical consumption is, of course, not consuming as much.
Right.
I think, you know, so these
are
major things.
And that's to do too, as you can imagine. I mean, we do, you know, so we the place we confronted that, which was a really good example of that, is so we rate beverages, food and beverages, and you know, basically. You know, quite honestly, it'd be better to be drinking water than practically any of these beverages that are there, except for orange juice and milk. And you're at this point where you can say, you know, substitute away from that category entirely. Don't buy sodas, for example. They're bad for the for your health. They're generally bad for the environment. Just don't buy them. Or basically, if you do that, you actually reduce the utility to that large part of the audience that wanted to know which were the healthiest, even though they know that there's none of them are particularly good, or which were the most socially responsible because they're going to buy them anyway. And so the real challenge for us has been, and I think people have criticized Good Guide for this, and it's a legitimate criticism, is that we have not focused on changing macro consumption behavior. It is not don't buy a car, share one, use public transport. It's if you're in the market for a car, here are the options that you've got. And that's been, you know, that definitely has a downside when you're meeting up with kind of fellow practitioners like you, where it's like, I don't know, you know, do I actually really want to be telling people even to buy the best car that's in your rating system? You know, maybe I don't.
Indeed. I'd like to jump onto a completely different topic now. The conference is actually about collaboration between organizations to a large degree, as well as crowdsourcing. You know the culture and the legal structure of your organization, obviously. What do you think about the potential possibilities for collaboration with a lot of the other organizations that are doing this around the world that actually, from listening to you, have quite a lot in common in terms of their methodologies, in terms of scoring, the fact that they are all trying to produce mobile applications and even browser plugins? Do you think there's a possibility there?
Well, I think there's some that's already going on. So I think the kind of stuff I was talking about earlier is the easiest, which is, you know, NGO or ethical consuming project has actually looked at an issue and looked at the products or companies operating in a sector and come up with a very detailed evaluation that others of us that are essentially more aggregators of information can make use of. So that's a, you know, that's a kind of like starting level of collaboration I think that's already happening. I've been involved in a number of sort of like meetings that have primarily occurred in the U.S. to try to get a little bit better coordination between, you know, the variety of stakeholders that are operating in this space, whether it's the standard producers of corporate social responsibility data, or whether it's the eco or health certification players that are operating in the market, or whether it's NGOs that are actually trying to change consumer behavior. And not to say I'm frustrated by those conversations, but I do think we've kind of hit an impasse, because I think that there's a, you know, there's a kind of understanding that, boy, if we all used sort of one way of talking about a standardized way to structure the kind of information we generate, we'd be able to share it amongst ourselves more easily. I'm kind of generally skeptical about that, because I think it's an overwhelmingly complex job. I mean, I think that there's, you know, it's just not going to be easy to come up with. I've been involved in several different standard setting efforts, and I just like, I don't see us all agreeing that the right way to describe the facts associated with whatever, you know, worker rights is this. And anytime I publish, I'm going to use this structured information. I've kind of fallen back to the, you know, there may be certain areas of what we're working on where we ought to do a better job of sharing, and we probably should focus on those. And I like one area that that's clearly true in is in corporate identity. So basically being able to have a common system for referring to corporate entities so that when Org X rates some entity, at least I know with a reasonable degree of certainty who the hell it is that they're talking about. And the other is in sort of like what I would call commodity level, kind of commodity product level information. So corporate product identity, a UPC code, how does it match to a name? Is it available for sale at a certain retail outlet with the following geographic location? That kind of stuff is essentially kind of infrastructure that any group that's operating in this space needs to have access to, and is current almost everybody, and certainly I'm speaking for us, we're certainly challenged by it, and we have probably more financial resources than most. Those are tough problems to solve, repeatedly requiring groups that have an issue focus but not a lot of technical resources to try to manage those types of problems seems to me to be very counterproductive and a waste of resources. I would love to find a way to basically, we're starting to see some of this happen in the U.S. now. I don't know what the situation is like in Europe, where, you know, several different organizations, Sunlight Foundation is the big one, is basically they're tracking corporate engagement in the political and lobbying process in the U.S., assigning standard identifiers, making available through APIs the ability to grab an identifier, a corporate name, and say, you know, total contributions to Republicans and Democrats, make it available to everybody so no one has to recreate that kind of information. Mm. I think we should be trying to identify and then kind of picking off, you know, who's going to do which of these kind of core tasks in a way that others can build off of. We've had, for example, a very tough time thinking about how to go international, because of the simple resources required to map between U.S. UPC codes and European UPC codes. Those are, you know, if we could solve that problem, then anyone in Europe could acquire Good Guide's product level data for matching products in Europe through our API and already have a set of facts about a product that would otherwise cost them quite a bit of money to create. So I do see some bridging technologies that would be worth collaborating on. I think that's more productive than trying to, in essence, develop a kind of ontology or domain map that we all agree defines how we all understand the world, because I just have not seen too many of those outside some very narrowly focused, mainly in software, you know, technology development efforts or ISO standards, something like that. It just hasn't happened. And I think the closest we're going to get on CSR type issues is sort of what we already see in the Global Reporting Initiative, and it's just not sufficiently refined to be kind of made automatable, and anybody who invests in that at this point is probably wasting scarce technical resources.
Okay, well, that's been really interesting. Sounds like you're being very successful with the amount of users that are getting involved there. So I'm very excited to see what happened.
It's all relative, right?
Yeah.
Yes, I'd say relative to the rest of the ethical consuming world. No, relative to, you know, Angry Birds or...
Absolutely.
Angry Birds is really I was just reading yesterday, there's like a, you know, 14-year-old in the U.S. who's done this little, you know, bounce a little balloon free app for the iPhone, which is now the top, you know, top downloaded iPhone app. It's like there are some things that are people that are basically largely pointless, certainly entertaining, but largely pointless that everybody's adopting. And, you know, you can't but look at that and wish that was your app, right?
Yeah, I mean, the question I think that obviously follows from that is, how do we make this largely entertaining?
And the challenge is quite
funny.
It's really tough because the core of what we're doing, right? I mean, so we've looked at, you know, had people in game, you know, what can we do to gamify our mobile
app? Yep.
We tried, you know, letting people get into competitions about, you know, how green is their bathroom or how green is their kitchen by scanning products and getting points and stuff like that. And you can make slow headway doing that. The real challenge is when you're into ethical consuming, you are often, at least half the time typically, and often more, telling people that something they are doing is bad, right?
Absolutely, yeah,
it's
yeah.
It's like, that's not fun. And as long as there's a kind of negative information component to a lot of what we do, which I think is inescapable, whether it's at the global level of don't consume or at the product level of, you know, this one is worse than that one, but something you've been buying all your life actually sucks. Those are tough messages to convey, and it really would require a user interface genius that we don't have right now. Actually kind of make it fun to hear that kind of information.
We've been actually looking into that because, I mean, obviously you can express, you know, 5 out of 20 in two different ways. You can express it as 15,
right?
Or you can express it as 5. You know, you can express it, you know, if someone's got a bad mark in 3 of the 8 categories, you can put a smiley in 5 of them or a big black blob in 3 of them. You know, so there are always two ways of expressing this data, which is interesting, yeah.
Right. But remember, those are still, you know, we're talking inside baseball here because that's almost like I think you probably have seen the U.S. version of Consumer Reports. You know, they have these little circles, and consumers have been well-trained to think of a, you know, fully filled-in circle is good and an empty circle is bad over multiple attributes. The challenge is that's still kind of restricted to the information seeker audience. And what we need is our long-term vision, quite honestly, is we kind of disappear as a destination site in our own right. As more and more individuals basically have access to essentially consumer product decision support systems, whether they're embedded in their mobile phone or embedded in the recommendation engines of e-commerce sites, the key for us will be becoming the provider of the sort of attribute stream, this environmental health and social attribute stream. And basically people will set their preferences and their phone will make their decision for them. And you know, it's like then you kind of have moved it from the world of this is something you need to think about, this is something, and automated it in a way that it's like anybody's willing to say, hey, we see this all the time in surveys. You know, a large proportion of the U.S. consumer marketplace says they're at least willing to consider green impacts, environmental impacts when shopping or would like to do more to help the planet or whatever. And then far fewer people act on that. And so to close that intention action gap, I think the long-term strategy has got to be, you know, you just elicit the preferences. So what are your intentions? And then you automate the process of being able to shop based on those preferences. And right now, that kind of automation is generally unavailable. And so it may take 5 to 10 years to get there, but with, you know, we're seeing now in the U.S., people being able to, experiments being done where, and I'm sure this is probably even more advanced in Europe at this point, bring your mobile device in, you know, scan the products as you place them in your shopping basket onto your mobile device, and then you check out simply by waving your mobile device as you're on your way out of the store. In that kind of context, it's much easier to imagine, you know, red blinking light as you put the objective and voice instruction, a better product is two shelves over and one shelf up, right?
Yeah.
But we're some way from that in terms of being able to deliver on it.
It's hilarious, all the sorts of things that could be said at the point that you try and check out there, you know.
Right.
No, you shouldn't have bought that, stop.
Well, and that's the key, I think. It's like that if you want to reach folks, you know, there's some folks who want to be reached before they get into the store, but they're a pretty small number. And then there are folks care and who might change their behavior, but you got to get them right then and there in a way that's really engaging and really easy for them to respond to. And that's really a pretty overwhelming challenge for all of us that are working in this space.
Sure. We're going to have about 10 interviews available at the end of this process. There are lots of things in common that you have with a few other organizations. There are also some quite radically different things happening as well. For example, there's Dr. Ellis Jones. I don't know if you know him.
I think I did look. I looked through, you know, the sort of who your other participants were and stuff like that. So, yeah, I think I looked at his site, actually.
He's produced a pocket-sized book
yeah.
and a little card with
right.
the top 10 worst and the top 10 best companies on. So yeah. very interestingly different approaches. A lot of your scoring systems are very similar to other people's scoring systems. So what we're going to do, we're going to publish them for you to look at as well, of course, if you want to
sure.
stay in touch with what other people are doing. We're going to produce a talk, which we're crowdsourcing, of course,
yeah.
just to be ironic about it, which I think I've sent you a link to.
You
if
did,
you
want yes.
to put stuff into. And then we're going to present that talk at the conference, which we will be streaming online. And hopefully, I mean, I guess a lot of great things can come out of this in terms of collaboration, not in terms of sharing data, but in terms of learning from what other organizations are doing. So, I mean, if someone does invest very openly in crowdsourcing, as in they try to get all of their data from people to look at what happens from the marketing side of that, and see what happens there and see what sort of models they can do to try and ensure good data quality, you know, like the sort of very intricate Wikipedia style stuff. So, yeah, I mean, sharing models as much as anything,
yeah.
if not directly, legally, combining completely and globally,
right.
which
well,
is unlikely to happen. I really don't.
Right. I think there's limited, no prospect of that. But we're certainly interested in kind of learning from others what is working and conveying to others what, you know, don't try to reinvent this wheel. It's really a dead end.
That one doesn't roll.
Yeah.
Okay, that's just under an hour, so that's brilliant.
I enjoyed the call. Thank you very much for
it. Was really good. You were very, very precise there and really explained everything well, so I really feel like I know a good guy very well there. So we'll let you know when that's gone up online.
Please do.
And we'll put in the executive summary with others and hopefully have a chat with you again.
Okay. Thanks a lot.
All right. Thanks.
See you.
Bye.